The exposure triangle is a common way of associating three variables that determine the exposure of a photograph, a video, or a film. Those include the aperture, the shutter speed, and the ISO. One must balance all three of these to achieve a desired result. Adjusting one usually means adjusting at least one of the others. They do not only affect the exposure, but are also the largest determiners of the global appearance of any image. Thus, their mastery is absolutely critical, both for technique and composition. And by the time this video is done, I'll explain to you each of the three aspects of the exposure triangle, so you could start to master your own skills. Hi, I'm Jim Costa. I'm a videography, photography, and technology guru, and I created this blog to help you to become a tech-savvy senior. Now, my tips and advice are useful to anyone, but my specific focus is in helping senior citizens to become more familiar with technology to improve and better their lives. If you have a camera question, go ahead and leave it in the comment section below, and I'll answer it. I do actually read all the comments, and I personally respond to each and every one of them. I've created many other videos on improving your photography and videography skills, and I'll link to those in the comment section below as well, and both during and at the end of this video, so stay tuned. If you want to learn more, remember to subscribe to my YouTube channel and hit that bell to be notified when I upload new videos. I upload every week on Wednesday, and I'll be uploading more in-depth explanations of film, video, and photography topics. What is the exposure triangle? Well, side one is the aperture. Aperture is a measure of how open or closed the lens is. The wider the aperture, or the lower the f-number, means that more light will be let in by the lens, simply because the opening is larger. A narrower aperture, or a higher f-stop number, allows less light into the sensor. You might wonder, why we would ever want less light to reach the sensor? The answer is that a majority of time, we want a larger depth of field. Depth of field is a byproduct of aperture. Narrower apertures, higher F numbers, give a greater depth of field, allowing more of the scene to be in focus. Think about videos or films or pictures of landscapes, for example. Wider apertures, lower F numbers, create a narrower depth of field, which can help isolate a subject and is one of the greatest compositional tools at your disposal. Consider portraiture photography, for example. You should also note that most lenses are their sharpest around f5.6 to f8. However, many photographers are willing to trade some sharpness for the subject isolating effects of a wider aperture. Side two of the triangle is shutter speed. Shutter speed is a measure of how long the shutter remains open and thus how long the sensor is exposed to light, or film if you're using film. Faster shutter speeds give the sensor less time to collect light and thus result in lower exposure. Slower shutter speeds allow more time for the sensor to collect light and result in higher exposure. In this case, the reason we might want to use a higher shutter speed is to stop motion, whether that be from camera shake or the subject is moving. This allows the subject to remain in focus. Remember, as long as the shutter is open, the camera is essentially recording the position of elements in the frame. If one of those elements moves, the result is often undesired blurriness. Many photographers will argue that this is the most important aspect of your exposure, saying that if your shutter speed isn't fast enough to give you a sharp image, nothing else will save the image. Side three of the triangle is ISO. Back when film ruled the land, there wasn't the kind of flexibility in this third side that we have now. One could control the sensitivity to light of the film they used, but once the roll was in the camera, there was no changing it, unless you had a swappable back, and these were generally restricted to medium format cameras. Nowadays, we can control the sensitivity of the digital sensor on the fly, though technically we're not controlling the sensitivity, This actually controls a post-image gain applied to the signal. But for all intents and purposes, you can think of this as sensitivity. Increasing the ISO essentially allows you to work with less light. As always though, there's a trade-off. Increased ISOs result in increased noise and less detail. Noise is the result of random fluctuations in an electrical signal. At lower ISOs, the magnitude of the image signal is large relative to the noise, or the signal-to-noise ratio, meaning that the noise generally remains unobtrusive. When working at higher ISOs, the image signal is generally close in magnitude to that of the noise, and thus noise enters the image. Amplifying a signal through the use of high ISO means a relatively high level of noise will be amplified too. All this means a grainy image. That's the most important thing to remember. So why ever use a high ISO? Well, often, when working in lower light, you will find yourself at the point where you are using the widest possible aperture and the slowest shutter speed you can to stop the action. At this point, your only choice is to increase the ISO. The lens cannot physically open itself any wider, so you're sacrificing sharpness for a slower shutter speed, and that's not generally advisable. I would rather have a grainy image that shows a well-defined subject than a smooth image with a subject that's lost in blur. Now, if this is all making sense to you, but tech-savvy senior in the comments section below. Let's put it all together. Exposure values and f-stops. We call a specific combination of aperture, shutter speed, and ISO an exposure value, or EV, and often refer to a change that either doubles or halves the amount of light reaching the sensor, or doubles or halves the sensitivity as a stop based on the f-stop scale of the aperture. This is where the math can get a bit annoying. Shutter speeds and ISO respond numerically how you would expect. A change from ISO 200 to 400 is an increase of one stop. A change from a shutter speed of 1/30th of a second to 1/25th of a second is a decrease of two stops. However, f-stops, which correspond to the aperture, that's the opening inside your lens, are arranged in a geometric series that roughly approximates powers of the square root of 2. So basically, in the following sequence, which is normally printed on your camera lens, each new f-stop represents a decrease of one stop. Some lenses go as low as f.8 or f1.4, f2, f2.8, f4, f5.6, f8, f11, f16, and f22. Those are printed on your lens, and you see them around the lens barrel if you ever look. So how do you intuitively work with doubling or halving an f-stop? The truth is, you just don't. Just memorize the sequence. It'll become second nature very quickly, and you'll have no problem jumping between stops and understanding exactly how many stops you've added or subtracted to your exposure. For example, moving from f2.8 to f8 represents a decrease of three stops, because it goes 2.8 to f4, from f4 to f5.6, and f5.6, f8. So we're now using 1/2 times 1/2 times 1/2, or 1/8 as much light. It's three stops. A note about image stabilization. Remember, it can help you to get away with a slower shutter speed that allow you to use narrower apertures for more depth of field, or lower ISOs for more detail. However, don't make the mistake of confusing camera shake with subject motion. Image stabilization only helps with the first of these. It is not ideal for static subjects. I very often see photographers with blurry photos or videographers with blurry video because their shutter speed was too slow for their subject. But they thought that image stabilization would save them. Trust me, it will not. So let's take a look at some pictorial examples of the exposure triangle. Notice how every time I reduce the aperture by one stop, I also decrease the shutter speed by one stop. Thus, the overall exposure is the same in each shot. Nonetheless, the differences are quite noticeable. In the F1.4 example, the flower in the center of the frame is quite prominent and isolated. The busy deck railing melts away rather nicely. However, by F8, my depth of field is much bigger, the deck railing is much more prominent, and it isn't clear what the focus of the image is. Also, in the last two images, I'm really beginning to risk camera shake by shooting at speeds slower than the reciprocal of my focal length, which in this case was 1/85th of a second. Notice how in this set, I simply couldn't keep the camera still enough for an exposure of 1/8th of a second at 85mm lens. By increasing the shutter speed 4 stops to a reasonable speed for that focal length, and compensating by increasing the ISO 4 stops, I'm able to get a sharp image with a large depth of field. Remember that high ISO, sharp image is always preferable to a low ISO, blurry image. Knowing the exposure triangle is crucial to getting technically correct images and controlling your composition. Put your camera in manual mode and begin experimenting with the three variables. You'll have an intuitive grasp of all of them before you know it. My question of the day is, how did you use the exposure triangle to improve the quality of your photo and video work? Leave a comment below and let us know. I'd love to hear from you. Do you want to see more videos like this? Follow my YouTube channel, Jim Costa Films, for more. Think what you saw was great? Like it. Do you have an opinion? Comment below. Do you know someone who could benefit from the information that I provided? Share the video. You want to learn even more? If so, then connect with Jim Costa Films on social media and online on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, of course, and the web. I currently have over 4,200 videos on my YouTube channel, Jim Costa Films, so feel free to check out many of my other videos for great tips and suggestions. Now, I also have a new Facebook group called Video Producers and Content Creators. So look for that on Facebook to connect there, join the group, and get even more pro tips and tricks.